Biden administration seems hell-bent on re-entering that disastrous Iran nuclear deal that President Trump pulled out of in 2018. Remember, the Biden foreign policy team is filled with former Obama staffers who helped create that very deal. For more on this, we spoke to Jonathan Schanzer. He's the Vice President for Research at the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies in Washington and a top expert on the U.S.-Israel relationship. And welcome to The Watchman. We just witnessed what may have been the most pro-Israel administration in American history. And ironically enough, Donald Trump's tenure in office followed what some have called the most anti-Israel administration led by Barack Obama. Now we have a new team in office, and there are concerns that President Joe Biden could usher in what amounts to a third Obama term when it comes to America's Middle East policy, especially concerning Israel. And folks, the early signs are not promising. As of mid-February, after nearly a month in office, Joe Biden still had not spoke to Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. During that time, Biden did speak to the leaders of several key U.S. allies like Britain, France, Germany, South Korea, and Canada. He even spoke to the leaders of Russia and China, both U.S. adversaries. But he just couldn't find the time to call the leader of America's closest ally in the Middle East. Every U.S. president since Ronald Reagan has reached out to his Israeli counterpart within days of taking office, until President Biden. Folks, I see two major reasons behind this snub. First, just old-fashioned pettiness. Joe Biden was vice president under Barack Obama, and Obama had a very contentious relationship with Netanyahu. Biden has not forgotten. Second, and much more troubling, is ideology. For starters, the Biden administration seems hell-bent on re-entering that disastrous Iran nuclear deal that President Trump pulled out of in 2018. Remember, the Biden foreign policy team is filled with former Obama staffers who helped create that very deal. For more on this, we spoke to Jonathan Schanzer. He's the Vice President for Research at the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies in Washington and a top expert on the U.S.-Israel relationship. Take a look. I think of some of the architects of that Iran nuclear deal, and one name in particular, John, that's caused a lot of stir among pro-Israel advocates is Robert Malley. He's the Biden administration's new point man on Iran. Tell us about him and why he may be problematic in that role.
So Rob Malley has definitely ruffled a lot of feathers. This is a guy who, both in government and out, has been seen as perhaps a little too cozy with some of Iran's officials, or even with some of Iran's proxies. Just even from the writings that he's done, the things that he's written publicly, you see that he's, you know, I would say sympathetic to the Houthis in Yemen, an Iran-backed terrorist organization, a little ambivalent about the Second Intifada and the impact of it on Israel, Hezbollah, Hamas. You kind of get a sense that he's just a little permissive in ways that, let's just say, advocates of a stronger U.S.-Israel relationship don't appreciate.
Number one, do you think that is likely, that the U.S. under Biden does try their hardest to re-enter the deal? And number two, just real quick for our viewers, could you give us a quick refresher course on why the Iran deal was so problematic, not only for Israel, but for America's security?
Sure. And I think that that's probably the place to start here. If you go back and look at that deal signed in 2015, it was highly problematic for a number of reasons. One, it had a bunch of sunsets, including at the five-year mark, the end of the arms embargo. Then at the eight-year mark, you had the end of the ballistic missile restrictions. And then by years 10 through 12 or so, really all the rest of the restrictions went away. In addition, you had sanctions relief that yielded Iran billions of dollars and allowed them to engage in commerce in the open market, which is not what you want to do with the world's foremost state sponsor of terrorism that had been hiding elements of a military program that had a nuclear component to it. Now, what we've learned actually since the signing of that deal, after the Israelis went into Iran and stole a bunch of documents from a secret nuclear warehouse, is that there was a military dimension. There's no question about it. There were secret facilities that had not been disclosed. So Iran has been not entirely truthful And in the meantime, they benefited greatly from the deal that America greenlit.
What comes next, I guess, in the next few years in terms of potential conflict between Israel and Iran? And Iran, of course, is still threatening retaliation over the deaths of not only Qasem Soleimani, but their nuclear mastermind, Mohsen Fakhrizadeh. It seems like things may be about to heat up in the Middle East, and they were already pretty hot.
They were already pretty hot, and you get a sense that Israel has tried to seize the initiative, not only in striking figures in Iran, but also really turning up the heat in Syria, where they've been bombing a lot of military targets in the middle of the night. And, you know, whereas before they wouldn't necessarily claim responsibility, they're openly claiming responsibility now. So this is a direct challenge to the Islamic Republic. And speaking of which, there was also a statement by Israel's, the IDF's chief of staff the other day. Kohavi came out and said that he saw the Iran deal as something that was extremely bad for the United States to get into. Remember, this is a professional military man saying this, not a politician. And he also said that Israel would be dusting off plans that it had already devised as a means to potentially knock out that nuclear program through military means. So very strong words coming from the head of the Israeli military. The other thing to just note here, by the way, is that it won't only be Israel this time coming out against the nuclear deal and potential diplomacy between Iran and the United States, but now you've got the UAE, you've got Bahrain, Morocco, Sudan, and potentially some other Arab countries that are part of that broader normalization trend that we saw in the last year of the Trump administration, where you now have a different chorus of voices and also potential military assets that Israel can use as part of a coalition.
Thanks again to Jonathan Schanzer for joining us. Hey everyone, thanks for checking out the Watchman newscast. If you enjoyed this episode and want to see more, make sure you go ahead and hit the like button, click subscribe, and tap the bell icon to turn on notifications for new Watchman newscast episodes every weekday.